Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have a discussion for the day 29th of August 2018. Today in our news discussion, we are going to deal five topics. Today's first topic is US-Mexico trade deal. You're all aware of the fact that US is following protectionist policy in recent times. This led to emerging of global trade war. Amid this rising global trade tensions, there is a sense of hope, there is a sense of relief now. What is that? The United States and Mexico reached a breakthrough in bilateral trade agreement. Earlier, Trump said that he is going to have an individual trade agreement with Mexico and Canada instead of going for NAFTA. According to this new agreement, 75% of all automobile content must be made regionally, which is higher than the current level of 62.5%. And further, 40 to 45% of such content must be manufactured at the cost at least $16 per hour. Why this change? What will be the impact of this change? Usually, manufacturers from United States moving their facilities to Mexico and establish their manufacturing sector here and produce whatever they want. Why manufacturers from USA moving towards Mexico means there is a cheap labor available with Mexico. In order to reduce this, USA bringing these changes. Notably, USA also invited Canada for similar talks and to have a similar trade agreement. Already, US President Trump was talking about abandoning NAFTA and going for individual agreement with Mexico and Canada, and this is the initial step, and US is expected to have a similar agreement with Canada also. Let's understand what is NAFTA briefly. It's a North American Free Trade Agreement between Canada, Mexico and US, creating a trilateral trade bloc in North America. It came into force on January 1, 1994. What is the market reaction to this new agreement between USA and Mexico? It's a very good sign and there is a sigh of relief because there is already global trade war is emerging. There is a trade war between emerging economy, between developed economy. But now this deal, this agreement brings hope because tit for tat tariff wars is not good for the global economy. It is worth noting that Mexico had earlier joined hands with other economies to impose retaliatory tariffs against the US. But now this new deal shattered everything. Mexico's decision could set an example for other countries to go for similar agreements with USA. China has been at the forefront of this approach. What is this approach? Retaliatory tariff approach, slapping tariffs on several US goods together worth of millions of dollars. So there is a misunderstanding, there is a limitation in the relationship between China and USA. This can also be resolved like USA-Mexico trade deal. Nobody is going to deny the fact that Mr. Trump's protectionist trade policy in order to protect US jobs, US manufacturing unit is really bad for global economy. In order to contain US, retaliatory tariffs will be imposed by other countries. It can cause further harm to the world economy by increasing burden of taxes on the private sector. This is not good. Why? Because the private sector is very crucial to have growth and create jobs. So we have to ensure that private sector is not burdened with taxes. And America's trading partners don't need to repeat the same mistakes committed by Trump by depriving domestic consumers to access the useful foreign goods, meaning that Indians have access to US goods. Just because US is putting tariff ban in the name of retaliatory tariffs, India also should not repeat the mistake because it will deprive the rights of Indians to access foreign goods. So what can be done? Peace talks would be the right response to Mr. Trump's trade war because going for tit for tat approach will not yield results for both black and win-win situation will not be prevailing. Today's second topic is Pieces of the Asian Dream. This year has so far been the year of India-China reset. Why we say this? Because after the Doklam standoff, there are good things are happening. From the informal summit at Wuhan, to Prime Minister Modi's keynote speech at Shangri-La Dialogue in Singapore, to SEO summit that held at the Chinese port city in Qingdao, these all the engagements bringing new hope to the bilateral ties of India and China. There is a geopolitical rivalry between US and China. So at this point of time, what steps India can take? What kind of strategic positioning India is gearing itself? In Singapore, Indian Prime Minister Modi's speech proclaimed India's ambitions to garner influence in the Indo-Pacific region. by increasing engagement with ASEAN nations, developing friendship with China, and maintaining cordial relationship with Russia, and pursuing interest with Australia, and engaging more with USA. Meaning that India wants to engage with every nation, whether it may be developed country or it may be emerging economy. India wants to have a peace, prosperity. India wants to have a good tie with every nation. So the question is, what shape will India's lead take? Even though India and China are engaging, there is a tug of war between India and China. This war continues to impact sea lanes and choke points, with these two Asian giants pursuing interest in the littoral states spread across Indo-Pacific. Both India and China wants to have influence in the Indo-Pacific region, but both nations' approaches are different. India is following different path, China is following, but the ultimate aim is same. What both countries wants to influence the countries that are located in Indo-Pacific region. India is pursuing its influence through heightened diplomatic, bilateral and military engagement. When it comes to China, it started to garner influence through cash, through investments. The littoral nations that are located in the Indo-Pacific regions are mostly suffering from massive infrastructural deficits. So China is leveraging this opportunity and is investing in a great manner so that it can influence these countries. China's heavy investment in ASEAN nations have brought these nations closer to its orbit of influence, that is, the orbit of Chinese influence. Despite there is an international ruling against China's activities in the South China Sea, the ASEAN as a bloc agreed to cooperate with China on code of conduct instead of pursuing international ruling. India enjoys cordial relationship with all the ASEAN nations. Nobody is going to deny that. But this relationship, this diplomacy alone is not enough. Meaning that China's raw cash power is huge when compared to India. China is investing in massive scale in all the nations so that it is getting more influence in the region. ASEAN trade with China is far more than compared to India, and Chinese foreign direct investment in ASEAN is 9 times higher than India. Not only in ASEAN countries, India also failed to provide any concrete plans for its immediate neighbor. For example, Nepal and Sri Lanka demonstrating interest in partnering with China. Our relationship with Nepal is not very good because of 2015 fuel blockade, and India's failed strategic interventions in Sri Lanka have impacted our regional leadership. On the other hand, China's multi-billion dollar investment in Sri Lankan ports and cities have inched the country much closer to China. Instead of having close relationship with India, Sri Lanka is moving towards China, which is a cause of concern for India because its regional leadership is being questioned. Last year, Sri Lanka handed over its Hambantota port to China on 99-year lease. However, the over-assertiveness of China has driven many countries in the East and Southeast Asia to seek India's bilateral ties, India's friendship. For example, Indonesia and Singapore are looking to enhance the relationship with India. Asian countries have a cultural affinity with India, with its shared religious diversity, ancient ties, and sizable Indian diaspora in countries like Singapore and Malaysia. Because after the US, India enjoys global soft power through its art, literature, music, dance, and cinema. Through this soft power, we can garner the support of various nations. India is perceived by many East Asian countries as a safe ally and a friendly democracy, which is a strength to India. Japan has significantly increased its ties with India, and these two countries having military engagement in a large scale. And India and Australia have initiated 2+2 dialogue in order to have maritime security in the region. But still, India has to develop a strategy to leverage its soft power and to optimize its military power to effectively counter China's cash and hard power. When compared to other nations, India has a better strategic bargaining power with China. Why? Because it would be difficult for China to take forward Belt and Road Initiative without the participation of India, because India has a reservation on China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. This China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is part of Belt and Road Initiative. Belt and Road Initiative is a China's massive investment program in which China wants India to participate, but India is denying because India is having reservations on China-Pakistan economic corridor. By demonstrating a willingness to join Belt and Road Initiative, India can positively influence China to re-evaluate the details of China-Pakistan economic corridor. With a strategic partnership with China, India can better pursue its own regional groupings like BIMSTEC and Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal initiative. In no way India can match with China's resource spending. So having strategic understanding with China will help streamline regional connectivity projects, and it will also help India to gain influence in the region. At the SEO summit, Mr. Xi Jinping renewed China's agreement with India on sharing data on the cross-border flow of waters from Brahmaputra during the flood season. That is, during flood season, the data will be shared between India and China, the amount of water that is passing through. And the two countries signed a protocol that would enable all varieties of rice exports from India to China, which is a demand pending from India for a long time. He also suggested that a trade target of $100 billion by 2020. This means that China wants to engage with India in terms of trade. India is clearly seeking its rightful place in the League of Nations by outlining its geopolitical role, particularly in the Indo-Pacific region. To attain this stage, it is better that India can cooperate with China in every aspect so that India's own interests are protected in the world arena. The next topic is Supreme Court finds audit of child shelters frightening. National Commission for Protection of Child Rights have conducted audit in shelter homes. The preliminary content of this results have made the Supreme Court to say that the results are frightening. Let's see what is this National Commission for Protection of Child Rights. This is a statutory body established in 2005 through an Act of Parliament. The commission works under the Ministry of Women and Child Development. The commission began operation a year later in March 2007. This commission is working to ensure that all laws, policies, programs and administrative mechanisms are in consonance with child rights perspective as enshrined in our own Indian Constitution and UN Convention on the Rights of Child. As defined by the commission, child includes up to the age of 18 years. This particular audit is being conducted in compliance with the Supreme Court order on May 5, 2017. In 2017 itself, Supreme Court ordered this NCPCR to conduct audit in child shelters. The preliminary results are really disturbing. That's why Supreme Court says that the preliminary content is frightening. Why it is saying that? Out of 185 shelter homes audited as of now across the country, only 19 had all the records of a child that they are supposed to maintain. Meaning that rules and regulations are not followed properly in the shelter homes. Of the 203 special adoption agencies, only 8 deserved positive reviews. That means that most of the agencies are not functioning well and they are receiving negative reviews. Similarly, only 16% of 172 observation homes audited till July 31st, they had all the required records of the children like case histories and who are residing there. Again, out of 80 special homes, place of safety, only 13% have the complete set of records, meaning that they are not having enough data. So let's have to wait for the complete results. Once the entire audit gets over, we will come to know the real fact, real situation of shelter homes, and we can also understand government's reactions and Supreme Court reactions. Let's wait and watch. The next topic is Punjab House passes bills to curb sacrilege. What is sacrilege? Disrespecting the religious sentiments of others. Punjab Assembly unanimously passed bills for an amendment to the Indian Penal Code and Criminal Procedure Code to make disrespecting of all religious texts punishable with life imprisonment. The Indian Penal Code Amendment Bill 2018 has inserted Section 295AA to provide that whoever causes injury, damage, sacrilege to Guru Granth Sahib, Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Holy Quran and Holy Bible with the intention to hurt the religious feelings of the people shall be punished with imprisonment for life. It also states the Indian Penal Code 1860 in its application to the state of Punjab in the section 295 for the words 2 years will be substituted by 10 years. The next topic is government scraps scientific panels and forms a new council. The government scrapped two scientific advisory committees for the Prime Minister and the Cabinet, and it replaced them with a 9-member Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council. In the new council, secretaries of various scientific ministries such as education, environment, health would be special invitees to the council meetings. Scientific advisory committees, the secretaries of these ministries will not be present, but now in the council, they are allowed as special invitees to attend the meetings. This Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council will be chaired by government's principal scientific advisor, Mr. Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan. The newly constituted body is expected to act as a high-level advisory body to several ministries and to execute mission-oriented programs. Thank you.